Hello, my name is Daniele, I am a 3D artist, and with this video I would like to show you the workflow to create this house in the middle of the woods. It's really easy, it's a very simple element created using different shapes. They are simple shapes, and yeah, let's get started. You start with a cylinder that you first mirror and then you dispose as an array, using an object both for mirroring and arraying it. This way you can scale the object and each duplicate will have a different size. You can actually mirror again the object using a different null object placed in the center of your scene, and then you can duplicate again the single element that you created and rotate 90 degrees to create the other wall of your house. In order to create the windows and the door, you simply have to use simple shapes like cubes. You scale them in order to create the size of the wall, the hole and the door. And then, well, I suggest you to merge them, so you can apply a single boolean to make the holes. You start creating the rooftop, you create again a simple shape and you duplicate. In this case you can duplicate as an array, but you don't really need an object to control the array. For the right side of the rooftop, I created a smaller piece that I basically duplicated as first and last piece. In this way the pieces look like they have been put together with a small gap in the center. For the piece that closes the front and the back, I created an additional element like plane. I subdivided into three pieces and then I applied a solidify effect and I beveled these three pieces. This way I created this kind of wooden axis that I use to close the front and the back of the house. Again, I duplicated them and I mirrored them, and that's it. In substance, it's just a single element that you create and you duplicate multiple times. For the chimney, I started with a cube that I moved on the back of the house and I scaled it down. I extruded and subdivided into multiple pieces that I kept extruding to create the simple shape. It's kind of forward to create, yeah. After that, I passed to the frames of the doors and of the windows. Again, I started with a cube that I scaled and I placed on the edges of the door. Again, when you have to work with this kind of stuff, you can always duplicate and mirror, so the left side and the right side is more or less the same. Again, you can also bevel them, so the shape will look a little bit smoother. And when the left and right side is the same, you can always mirror again. This will help you to save a lot of time. Also, when you want to modify the shape, you can easily do it. This operation can be repeated on the windows as well. Just be careful because the walls of the house are a little bit inclined, so after you create the shape, you will have to scale, rotate it around, I guess, 12 degrees. I didn't really check when I did it, I simply rotate. One advice: when you want to move or scale something that has been rotated in Blender, instead of pressing the axis that you want to alterate, press the axis twice. In this way you will move and scale on the local axis. So basically, as you can see, I'm scaling on the x-axis, that's actually points towards almost the z-axis, between z and x. Another advice is that you can always move your pivot point on the axis and on the position where your object rotates. In this way you can basically create windows, doors that open as you wish. For the small pieces of woods that are internal to the windows, I again use simple cubes that I rotated and I positioned inside of the window. And again, I simply duplicated and then mirrored. In this very case, I didn't really mirror them. I duplicated and rotated the duplicate. Then I passed to the ground. I started with a plane that I subdivided multiple times. This is because I wanted to move it up and down. And in order to do it, I have used the proportional editing features. I did some experiment at the beginning. I wanted to make it a little bit more different in terms of heights. But I think that for something like this, smooth was better. Then I extruded it down, and in order to smooth the lower part, I simply selected all the polygons and I scaled it to zero, so all of them will have the same height. And then to create the shape as a round shape, I have used a boolean. The trees have been modeled following a tutorial by Grant Abbitt, a great 3D artist that has a lot of good insights that you can follow to improve your workflow and learn new stuff. They have been created using simple shapes modeled from the edges with a skin modifier applied on the top. The great thing of the skin modifier is the fact that you can scale the edges of your shape. The second tree has been modeled simply copying some cones and applying some randomness to them, so small cuts and so on. While the third, that I actually think is the most interesting, is simply a single leaf that has been duplicated multiple times around a cylinder, a very thin cylinder. After that, I passed to the path in front of the house. For this one, I did some experiments. Originally, I wanted to be a single path, but I figured out that maybe using some steps, some kind of stones in the middle of the forest could be a more interesting thing, also to add variety to your final model. And in order to do that, again, I used an array modifier and I duplicated all the objects using an object for the offset. In this way, basically, all your step will follow this model. You can move them up, down. If you move the final model, basically the object that I have used as a guide to duplicate objects as an array, you can alter the path, so you don't really have to worry. And it's actually really customizable. Customizable? Is right? I think so. Anyway, I then pass to the light. A small advice, I think that it's better to start with the lighting and then coloring your objects rather than doing the opposite, because in this way you can see if the shapes are properly arranged. Usually when I put the lights on my model, I use a main light on the right side, a secondary light on the left side, and a backlight for the back. The main light is the brightest, the secondary light is a little bit less intense, and the one on the back is the less intense. Also, I use different colors to lead my object. This way I can add variety also in the shadows. After that, I color the background, and one of the interesting thing that I have done with this was adding a shadow catcher. Now, EEVEE doesn't really have the option to create shadow catchers. Basically Cycles had it. It was really useful. But I found a very nice tutorial online by Schillem. I hope that I read it right. I'm gonna put all of them in the description anyway. And in a couple of simple, how can I say, altering some nodes, you can create a very nice shadow catcher. So you can have an infinite background. That's what I want to achieve with this model. What I have done after that is adding colors to the objects. Now, for something so simple like this, my idea was to create a cartoon effect, like kind of Disney style. So I didn't apply too many shaders, I didn't apply reflectiveness. I actually decided to use two different kind of roughnesses. So a very rough material and a less rough material. So in this case, the illusion is basically done. The last thing that I have done was adding a camera. So first I started focusing on my object. Originally the tutorial was intended for Instagram, so my idea was to create something for the Instagram feed. Cutting different parts of the tutorial I could actually include in a YouTube, Vimeo and so on. So I added the camera and I linked the camera to a null object. It's easier because you can always focus on the null object. So in this way, you can always focus on the house or any element of the house if you want. Then I linked the camera to a path, a round path. In this way, the camera will rotate and you don't really need to worry too much. When you do that, you can spend a little bit because you need to find the right axis where to point the camera. I included some smoothness in the movement. You can always decide how long does it take for the camera to do the whole rotation. After that, I have rendered my mesh. I always suggest you to render using a format like JPEG or EXP sequence. In this way, if the render interrupts, you can start again from the last frame that didn't render. You can always put it together using another application or Blender itself. Blender has a great video editing feature, so you can always do that. I think that this is all. It's a very quick tutorial. It's actually my first tutorial. So if you have comments or critiques, write me. You can write me on my account or you can leave a comment underneath. And I hope that you learned something, and let me know what you would like to see next. Bye.